Philippine architecture covers a myriad of expressions, forms, types, styles, and periods. Its primeval expression resided in nature. For the early Filipinos who were defenseless before the violence of wind and rain, the cave was a refuge, a place of dwelling. The petroglyphs in a rock shelter in Angono, Rizal provides evidence of the ancient Filipino's effort to embellish his habitation, while the mountaintop citadels of Savidug Batanes is a testimony to the sophisticated defensive engineering of the early Ibatan settlers. Emerging from the caves, our ancestors initiated the first architectural revolution with the invention of stone tools for cutting fibrous materials from plants. This helped develop the lean-to, a temporary tent-like shelter made of wooden skeleton and vegetative or animal skin. The treehouse was another shelter fashioned from nature, constructed around, next to, or among the trunk or branches of one or more mature trees while above ground. They are usually found in areas where violent intertribal conflict and nocturnal raid are frequent. The cultures of Southeast Asia have descended from a common ancestry based on affiliation with the Austronesian family of languages. Its culture is characterized by a waterborne lifestyle. Vernacular architecture in the Philippines professes a strong allegiance to a greater Austronesian building heritage, for the archetypal house consists of an architectural system of a raised wooden structure elevated on posts with a thatched pitch roof and decorative gable finials. The prototypical bahay kubo is usually built with wooden posts as its framework. The four posts of the Ifugao house, which is both granary and home, is distinctive for circular rat guards, while the Maranao Torogan stands on stout log posts resting on round stones. Houses built on the seabed, like the Bajau houses, are raised on slender posts or stilts. Cross gable finials, which hold the rafters together at the ridge, are an ever-present feature of Southeast Asian roofs. In the monsoon-beaten Batanes Islands, the dwellings are designed and built to withstand the battering of the most severe of storms, sea sprays, and earthquakes. With knowledge of processing lime for building that was introduced in the 18th century by Spanish colonists, the Ibatans are able to construct their more familiar house made of stone and mortar, known as kal y kanto. In the altitudes of the mountain province, the vernacular houses were designed primarily to shield from the cold weather and designed in relation to the terrain of the mountains, while lowland vernacular dwellings were open to light and ventilation, a typology best embodied by the bahay kubo. Depending on the ecology of the vicinity, the bahay kubo may be constructed from various kinds of botanic materials, primarily of bamboo and thatch. The Spanish Empire's attempts to bring Mindanao under its dominion were continuously foiled by its people, who were consolidated by the religion and political structure of Islam. A religion based on congregational worship, which requires a permanent and distinct architecture called the mosque. The oldest standing mosque in the Philippines, found in Tubig, Indangan, Simunol Islands, Tawi-Tawi, is a prototype of the multi-layered roof of the pagoda-style mosque. Later mosques were rendered in a style approximating Middle Eastern models. the Golden Mosque in Quiapo, Manila, notable for its gilded dome, combines modern mosque design with stylized and colorful Maranao Okir patterns. The geographic features of Sulu and Mindanao have encouraged both terrestrial and naval architecture, such as the Samal, the Tausug, the Yakan, and the Bajau. Descending from the Austronesian lineage, the houses in different Muslim societies in the southern Philippines are categorized into three. Land-based stilted dwellings situated along the shoreline. Oceanic stilt dwellings built completely over the sea and entirely detached from the shoreline. And the houseboat, which is both home and fishing boat. Vernacular architecture is a broad category denoting indigenous, folk, tribal, ethnic, or traditional architecture found among the different ethno-linguistic societies in the Philippines. Undeniably, the vernacular architectural tradition is an omnipresent building practice in the country and remains an accessible architectural idiom to the majority of Filipinos. With cross and sword, Miguel Lopez de Legazpi in 1565 took possession of Philippine Islands in the name of the Spanish crown. Initially, Legazpi founded settlements in Cebu and Panay, but moved northward to Luzon. The goal was to conquer the fabled Muslim settlement of Manila because of its strategic position. In 1571, the Spaniards successfully occupied the charred remains of the settlement abandoned by Raja Sulaiman, chieftain of Manila. In time, the settlement of light materials gave way to a stone-fortified metropolis, a Spanish-walled city, Intramuros, was taking shape within less than a mile in area, spreading out from the point of a triangle, bordered by the bay and the river. The devastation caused by the 1583 fire and the 1645 earthquake resulted in the invention of a hybrid type of construction, the arquitectura mestiza, which combined wooden frames and stone. This flexible construction, which used wood in the upper floor and stone in the lower floor, had a better chance of surviving an earthquake. While Intramuros was being built and reconstructed, the Spaniards ventured inland. To accomplish the territorial and spiritual takeover, the colonial space was redesigned according to an urbanizing program known as Reducción. The small, scattered clusters of native settlements were forced to consolidate into single, larger, and compact villages to easily manage every affair of the native populace. These new towns followed the urban master plan prescribed by the 1573 Royal Ordinance of King Philip II, known as the Laws of the Indies. It decreed that the town plan should establish a main plaza or plaza mayor. Around the huge and open square of the plaza was a complex of prominent buildings of colonial governance: the church and convent, the Casa Real or town hall, the tribunal, the official residence, and other important government buildings. The marketplace and residences of various social classes were also distributed hierarchically around this complex. The colonial condition bred a new kind of lifestyle and activities which characterized the emerging urban life. The Spanish building program was driven by the aesthetics of monumentality. Thus, Spanish colonial architecture was built of sturdier and more permanent materials using imported methods of construction. Many churches and other institutional structures were built under the direction of architects or maestro de obras or master builders, many of whom were priests. Builders, largely Chinese, were often employed under a contractual system called pakyao. The colonial government also used the tax system of polo y servicio, which generally compelled every able-bodied male to render labor service for public construction to sustain the building activities. The building of garrisons, naval constructions, and fortresses was a military strategy to safeguard the colonial territories. Intramuros was the foremost fortification built by the Spanish crown. The religious orders undertook the spiritual governance of the Filipinos and initiated the building of ecclesiastical edifices, churches, belfry, monasteries, and convents. In newly founded parishes, the church occupied the most prominent site of a town and functioned as a site of evangelical mission in the area. The earliest churches were rendered in the vernacular idiom, simple in plan and fashioned of light materials with a high-pitched roof. Inside, the floor was either raised or of compacted earth, defining a rectangular nave. These structures were later expanded and made of adobe stone, coralline limestone or brick, and were reinforced with buttresses to ensure their strength during earthquakes. Ultimately, the churches evolved into monumental stone sanctuaries that allowed indigenous motifs to coexist with European styles. The Chinese and native artisans interpreted and executed the ornaments from classical, Romanesque, Gothic, Baroque, Rococo, and Mudéjar sources, not strictly according to formal rules of the style, but on their own aesthetic discretion, often in simplified form and incorporated with local tropical motifs and Chinese decorative elements, which exemplifies the tendency of colonial ornamentation towards hororvacui. The whole external composition was lorded over by one or two bell towers or campanario, ranging from 3 to 5 stories. The towers attached to the church were usually provided with a baptistry at the ground floor. Adjacent to the church was a parish house called convento. It served as lodging house for visiting dignitaries, storerooms for food and armaments, school, office, and parish archives. Another component of the church complex was a graveyard or Campo Santo. From the 17th and 19th century, a new domestic prototype sprung from 2 centuries of development. The Bahay na Bato descended from the Bahay Kubo and resembled the Arquitectura Mestiza in the 17th century. These houses were typically 2 stories, with the ground story made of massive cut stone or brick walls, and the upper story level built of hardwood. The house was capped by a hip or gabled tiled roof with a steep slope. By the last quarter of the 19th century, Manila experienced an urban sprawl. Urbanization spilled over the old walls into the various arrabales or nearby suburbs. The accesoria or apartment dwellings were another consequence of industrialization that grew from the migrant laborers' need for cheap housing in commercial and industrial areas. Civic architecture, such as the Palacio Real, the Ayuntamiento, and the Aduana, epitomized the Spanish administrative institutions. The Casa del Ayuntamiento occupied an entire block on one of the sides of the Plaza Mayor of Manila. Across the Ayuntamiento was the residence of the highest official of the land, the Palacio del Gobernador General, or Palacio Real. 2 types of school buildings surfaced during the Spanish colonial period: the colegio, or universidad, found in urban areas, and the escuela primaria, found in different pueblos. These institutions had the privilege of having spacious buildings and broad courtyards, with a chapel at the center. Apart from these, the religious orders also took charge of the health and medical needs of the colonial subjects. Franciscans built the first hospital around 1564, the Hospital Real, which was also one of the first buildings to be erected in Manila. Colonial infrastructure and public works raised the living standards of its subject, and also dependent upon port and harbor facilities to integrate the colony with the routes of global commerce. Commercial buildings during the Spanish colonial era varied from small sidewalk stalls to huge factories. In 1809, European commercial houses were allowed to operate in Manila, and the influx of foreign commercial firms followed suit. Expatriates launched their businesses on Escolta and adjacent streets. The early trading houses and commercial firms retrofitted the Bahay na Bato. Here, the ground floor was occupied by offices and shops, while the upper story functioned as the residence of the proprietor of the company. The colonial amusement and public diversions were few and often dominated by theater and cockfighting. Teatro de Binondo and Teatro Circo Zorrilla were designed specifically for theatrical dance and musical performances. The persistence of cockfighting led to the regulation of the game and building of cockfighting arenas or sabungan. Illegitimate forms of leisure also persisted in the urban precincts, especially in the commercial district of Binondo, where functional spaces for gambling, prostitution, and opium consumption were housed. Lasting for 333 years, the Spanish colonial rule came to an abrupt end at the turn of the 19th century. With Spain's defeat in the Spanish-American War, a new era dawned. A new architecture was to emerge, shaped by American imperial ambition and the logic of manifest destiny. After pacifying the Filipino rebellion, the American occupation forces turned to rebuild the Philippines. The Americans sought to reshape Manila's urban environment after an imperial image of a well-ordered, healthy, and beautiful tropical city. To do this, the military government under General Arthur MacArthur placed all public works concerns under the United States Army Corps of Engineers. The Corps also undertook the improvements of the Port of Manila. Soon after, the Commission created the Bureau of Engineering and Construction of Public Works and the Bureau of Architecture and Construction of Public Buildings to oversee the production of colonial infrastructures. Through these agencies, the American regime deployed its resources to build public architecture. It was also within the institutional framework of the BPW that Filipino pioneer architects would receive their architectural tutelage. The early years of American occupation was beleaguered by a succession of epidemic diseases, and ordinances were issued to regulate and modify vernacular dwellings. This brought many technological changes to Filipino domestic space in the name of colonial sanitation. The resulting hybrid house was called chalet. This house was a single-story structure with a front porch constructed of either entirely of wood or a combination of ferroconcrete and wood. To stop the unsanitary practice of bathing and washing in the esteros, the authorities established a new type of communal architecture that combined the functions of toilet, bath, and laundry, supplied continuously with clean water. The Americans introduced in 1908 the neighborhood concept known as sanitary barrios, which permitted nipa houses to be built on highly regulated blocks of subdivided lots. Meanwhile, insular architect Edgar K. Byrne, chief of the Bureau of Architecture, designed set-piece architecture that mimicked the styles of Spanish colonial buildings. The Spanish Mission Revival. The Government Laboratory. Municipal Building of Manila. The Insular Ice Plant and Cold Storage. Government Printing Office. And Customs House exhibited the penchant for pseudo-Spanish imagery. One of the priorities of the colonial administrators was development of a master plan for Manila and the hill station in Baguio. Their aim was to install a sense of cosmopolitan arrangement to Manila's chaotic patchwork of communities and create an upland health resort in Baguio. Daniel H. Burnham, a prominent American architect, was appointed for the job. Burnham's corpus of work earned him a reputation as the father of the City Beautiful movement. Carefully designed vistas, Grand Civic Center, axial and radial boulevards, classicist formality, and green open spaces and parkways were hallmarks of the City Beautiful. The master plans aimed to reconfigure Manila and Baguio as a testimony to American imperial presence and technological modernity. For the implementation of his urban directives, Burnham endorsed William Parsons. As consulting architect, Parsons was responsible for the design of all the public buildings and parks for the entire colony. Guided by the master plan, neoclassical monumental forms slowly rose in the landscape, working to enhance the imperial image, colonial commerce, and native discipline. Neoclassical capital buildings, the embodiment of the American Republican ideals, rose in every provincial urban center. And it was through this style that the processes of democratic apprenticeship were made more tangible in modern reinforced concrete buildings sponsored by the colonial state. The Normal School, the Philippine General Hospital, the Manila Hotel, and the provincial capital buildings of Albay, Pampanga, Iloilo, Capiz, and Laguna were samples of his works that embodied this aesthetic gesture. For capital and municipal complexes, Parsons accorded these structures with a logical and convenient scheme, placing them in a park-like setting, in a position of dignity and repose. Parsons' neoclassic designs for the capitals became the archetype for all succeeding capitals built before and after the war. His contribution to local architecture was the improvement of quality of construction materials and technique. After designing the Insane Hospital in San Lazaro, the first reinforced concrete structure of the government, he promoted the use of ferroconcrete as the standard construction material for all government architecture. Apart from receiving technical training from the offices of BPW, deserving Filipinos who aspired to be architects were given scholarship by the government under the pensionado system. Upon graduation from an American university, Carlos A. Barreto, Antonio Toledo, Tomas Mapua, and Juan Arellano were absorbed in the colonial bureaucracy as high-profile civil servants. This batch of architects, together with Maestro de Obras Arcadio Arellano and Tomas Argueles, earned a place in the annals of Philippine architecture as the first-generation architects. Some of them ventured in other styles such as Art Nouveau, Neo-Castilian, and a variety of historical revivalism. By the late 1920s and 1930s, the dominance of neoclassicism was challenged by the second generation of Filipino architects who returned from their overseas studies and European trips. The leading protagonists were Andres Luna de San Pedro, Fernando Ocampo, Pablo Antonio, and Juan F. Nakpil. They introduced innovative ideas and novel ways of utilizing non-classical ornaments, which steered Philippine architecture to a new direction, the Art Deco. The buildings of the Art Deco were given to profuse abstraction and stylization, rich ornamentation, colorist effects, dramatic massing in simplified geometric forms, as well as exotic imagery derived from non-Western sources. The later manifestation of Art Deco, the streamlined deco, evoked the imagery of machine and mass production. Art Deco's exuberant exoticism and ornamentation were deployed in the facades of the Elpo Building, Bautista Nakpil Pylon, Metropolitan Theater, Santos House, and Mapua House. While the stripped classicism of Bulacan Capital, Cebu Capital, and the Sariaya Municipal Building demonstrated the transition from classical to Art Deco of government edifices. The stepped or zigzag silhouette of Art Deco was best captured by the Insular Life Building, Bawan Municipal Building, and the pylons of the Quezon Bridge. The streamlined and maritime imagery were admirably applied to the Rizal Memorial Stadium, Hialay Building, Bel Air Alhambra Apartments, Marsman Building, Lopez House, and the Far Eastern University Main Building. The craze for Art Deco coincided with the establishment of movie-going as a national pastime. Art Deco provided a fascinating escape, which common Filipinos found in the architecture of cinema palaces for a mere price of a ticket. Fantasy architecture prevailed. In 1934, the United States Congress mandated the establishment of Philippine independence within 12 years. As a first step, the Commonwealth of the Philippines was established in 1935 as transition government, with Manuel L. Quezon sworn in as first president. With the rapid population growth of Manila, Quezon contemplated a whole new city built from raw land to absorb the expected urban sprawl. But the Pacific War would frustrate Quezon's urban vision. With clouds of war at the horizon, General Douglas MacArthur declared Manila an open city on December 1941 to spare the city from damage from the advancing Japanese Imperial Army. The outbreak of World War II and the subsequent Japanese occupation of the Philippines brought widespread poverty, suffering, and death. The political and economic instability spurred by the occupation proved to be detrimental to architectural production. What happened during the three-year regime was a takeover of private and public buildings by the Japanese Imperial Army for military and political purposes. In February 1945, the Americans were set to reclaim Manila. The last days of war witnessed the wholesale destruction of Manila's built heritage and the irreplaceable treasures of colonial architecture. As Filipinos moved on to post-war reconstruction, they were gripped by nostalgia for the nation, a sense of mourning for the things lost during the war. Rising from the ashes, it was time to build a new nation. At the end of the Pacific War, Manila laid in ruin. yet war-torn Manila rose again. Out of the ashes, Filipinos moved on to rebuild their lives and found in modernism the foundation on which to erect a new nation. On July 1946, the Philippine Islands became the Independent Republic of the Philippines. The U.S. War Damage Rehabilitation Fund was also instrumental in resurrecting Manila's pre-war neoclassical splendor. The Manila City Hall, Post Office Building, Agriculture and Finance Buildings, Legislative Building, and a group of buildings of the University of the Philippines in Manila were rebuilt approximating their original plans. A construction boom followed suit. The architects joined the reconstruction euphoria. Post-war austerity meant straightforward and no-nonsense architectural forms, which modernism readily supplied. Form follows function, was the new doctrine proclaimed by the third-generation Filipino architects, namely Cesar Concho, Angel Nakpil, Alfredo Luz, Otilio Arellano, Felipe Mendoza, Gabriel Formoso, and Carlos Argüelles. Modern architecture's simplified geometries were in accordance to the demands of honesty expressed in materials, structure, and form. Maneuvered in restraint rather than indulgence, valuing simplicity over complexity. Mid-century modern aesthetics was also influenced by new materials and scientific events, particularly space exploration, which fueled much faith in technology and the future. This so-called space age of the 1950s had since been translated into a visual language of long, lean, horizontal lines, suggesting airplane wings, soaring upright structures, and parabolic arches that direct the eye to the sky, and sharply contrasted angles that express speed. Innovations in building materials, including reinforced concrete, plastic, and steel, made it possible for architects to manipulate materials to the point where buildings became sculptures. Advanced engineering techniques allowed new shapes and structural configurations to be performed in thin concrete shells, concrete folded plates, and space-framed structures. Soft modernism, as the name implied, experimented with the sculptural potential of concrete's plasticity to come up with soft and organic forms with the use of thin shell technology. Folded plate, on the one hand, was a roof structure whose strength and stiffness was derived from a pleated or folded geometry. It was a special class of shell structure formed by joining flat, thin slabs along their edges so as to create a three-dimensional structure. The brisolet, sun baffles, and pierced screens were simple devices applied externally to tropicalize and modulate the climate-insensitive designs of the international style. An improvement of the brisolet and the pierced screen was extensively adopted in Manila during the 1960s. The pierced screen functioned mainly as a diffuser of light and doubled as a decorative layer for the exterior. It is fabricated from perforated concrete or ceramic blocks, precast concrete, or aluminum bars with various ornamental punctures. After the oil crisis of 1973, architects began to realize the failures of modern buildings in the tropical climate. As such, Filipino architects were compelled to backtrack and reevaluate vernacular building traditions as sources of energy-efficient design, which in effect gave rise to a modernist strand known as tropical regionalism. With the amendment of Manila Ordinance No. 4131 in the 1950s, a high-rise fever swept and redefined Manila's skyline. Angel Nakpil's Picache Building, considered as the first skyscraper in the Philippines, reached 12 stories high. The Insular Life Building was the first office building to surpass the old 30-meter height restriction, ushering the vertical trend in Makati. To address the widespread homelessness, the People's Homesite and Housing Corporation, now known as National Housing Authority, new suburban communities were developed in Quezon City project sites. These projects offered various types of low-cost concrete bungalow units. The bungalow thus became the convenient model for post-war housing. For middle-income households, residential units in Film Life Homes were designed on a modular planning system by Carlos Argüelles. In upscale subdivisions established by the Ayala and Ortigas families, homes were designed not by company architect, but by an architect commissioned by the individual homeowner. Such allowed a great variety of domestic architecture in which the size of the carport was an index of status. Tall and multi-storied apartments played a new role in providing Filipinos with modern housing. Monterey Apartments and Carmen Apartments epitomized the modernist high-rise apartments of the period. By the middle of the 1960s, young architects and designers began to reappraise the country's rich architectural and cultural heritage as a source of design inspiration. Local architects adapted Maranao and southern Philippine motifs, exploiting vinta colors and roof silhouettes, resonating ambiguous Malayan figuration. The dictatorship of Ferdinand Marcos in the 1970s held the promise of national rebirth and resurrection of old Filipino traditions. The cultural and architectural agenda of the regime was placed under the auspices of the First Lady Imelda Marcos, who packaged herself as the patroness of the arts and tended the cultural renaissance of the nation. The colossal building projects of the Marcoses, cultural buildings, finance complexes, medical centers, bliss, hotels, convention centers, sports complexes, airports, official residences, and a Filipino theme park projected an image of a progressive and modern nation-state. The essential characteristics of the Bahay Kubo are reinterpreted by means of crisp modernist vocabulary in the cantilever projections in Leandro Loxin's buildings at the cultural center of the Philippines complex. The CCP Main Theater, Folk Arts Theater, Philippine International Convention Center, and the Philippine Center for International Trade and Exhibitions demonstrate Loxin's application of abstract cubist principles to distill the essential and floating qualities of the Bahay Kubo into sculptural edifices. A more profound allusion to the Bahay Kubo and a departure from the modernist box is Loksin's design for the National Arts Center. The pyramidical superstructure evoked the roof lines of Austronesian stilt dwellings. Such imagery was later rehashed for the other state buildings like the Batasang Pambansa and Baguio Convention Center. Taking the same romantic nationalist strategy, Francisco Manyosa used an imitative and straightforward approach for his Tahanan Filipino or Coconut Palace. Through this watershed building, Manyosa began to align more firmly his practice towards the advocacy of climate-responsive vernacular architecture, a body of work which made him the paternal figure of Filipino neo-vernacular movement. Modernism in the Philippines began to lose its popular appeal by the 1980s, as many came to realize that the austere modernist boxes were boring and lacked character. Postmodern architecture altered the landscape, with buildings proclaiming the resurgence of ornament as an antidote for modernism's renunciation of history and tradition. The minimalist dogma of modernism, less is more, was supplanted by a counter doctrine, less is a bore. Postmodernism adopted a populist aesthetic language heavily influenced by classical architecture. Visually, postmodernism is exemplified by garish application of color, return to ornament, and traditional design elements, an eclectic mix and match of every conceivable detail for a flashy effect. The postmodern skyscrapers allude to the timelessness of the classical column. As a way to break its vertical monotony, the tall structure is divided into vertical segments, podium, shaft, and crown. Typologically, this formula called tower on the podium is predominantly adopted for commercial and corporate towers because of their mixed-use potential. The theme park techniques of image making, suitably termed Disneyfication, results in a place of manufactured and controlled imagination. Postmodernism reinvents the cityscape with a potential illusion and perpetuate escapist fantasy environments as the master-planned micro-cities like Eastwood City, Fort Bonifacio Global City, and Rockwell Center, the retail environment of Mega Mall, and Greenbelt, and gated communities, which are all detached and protected from the harsh realities of third world urbanity. As the process of globalization engulfs the local architectural practice, one fears that the period of postmodern architecture in the Philippines might become the period of post-Filipino architecture. But perhaps, in all optimism, as in the past, the Filipino will prevail.